As a kid, my parents wouldn't let me leave the dinner table unless I finished every vegetable on my plate. As an adult, I told my parents there's no chance I'm coming home to visit unless no vegetable ever touches my plate. After 4 months on a carnivore diet, I think that the only way I'm going to survive a trip to my parents' house is if I can find an answer to the question, do humans need to eat plants to survive? Calories are the fuel source for biological life. Go long enough without recharging and you will die. Making calories the number one priority for short-term survival, regardless of their source. Our closest relatives, chimpanzees, share 99% of our DNA and get the majority of their calories through plant foods, not because of preference, but accessibility. It's hard to source animal products when you're hanging out at the top of a tree, which might explain their proclivity for eating monkeys and other chimps. When our ancestors diverged from chimps, leaving the trees for the African plains, our diet started shifting to include more meat. Why spend days foraging for dozens of calories from broccoli when one woolly mammoth will provide millions? For energy needs, calories are king, and we can get them from the most unlikely sources in the most desperate situations. But for long-term health, we need to get calories from essential macronutrients. Every calorie that our bodies can use comes from one of three macronutrient sources: carbohydrates, protein, or fat. Protein and fat are comprised of amino acids and fatty acids. There are 9 essential amino acids and 2 essential fatty acids. Essential means that our bodies can't function without them and also can't create them on its own, so we need to get them from the foods that we eat. Animal products contain all of the essential amino and fatty acids, rendering plant foods non-essential for protein and fat. The one macronutrient that animal foods don't have in any significant quantity are carbohydrates. You might be familiar with the term simple and complex carbs, but ultimately both of these are broken down into the same end product, which our bodies use as its primary fuel source: glucose. Unlike the amino and fatty acids, glucose is not essential because our body has 2 systems for dealing with its absence. The first is through ketosis, where our body shifts its primary fuel source from glucose to ketones, which it derives from dietary fat. The second is through gluconeogenesis, converting protein into glucose, providing us with the benefits of carbs without the consequences of overeating sugar. And both of these systems activated for me when I cut out all plant foods. The last remaining carbohydrate, which our bodies can't manufacture, is fiber. Our bodies can't directly digest fiber, but it feeds the bacteria in our gut, leading to its claim to fame, healthy bowel movements. Epidemiology is a discipline that studies population level data to find correlation between 2 events, like fiber consumption in a country and constipation amongst its citizens. Epidemiology is great for generating hypotheses, which we can test through interventional studies. Interventional studies, or clinical trials, provide participants with an intervention to measure how this affects some outcome. In this case, adding fiber to relieve constipation. In interventional studies, not only was adding plant fiber shown to have no benefit on constipation, but removing it from the diet relieved symptoms of constipation. 4 months without fiber or plants, and my results align with the results of this study, although my toilet bowl might argue that I should be seeking a channel sponsorship from Lysol. Interventional studies also disprove other hypothetical benefits of fiber found in epidemiological studies, including its addition increasing alpha diversity in the gut microbiome and accelerating weight loss, demoting fiber's role to inconsequential at best and harmful at worst. Drawing conclusions from epidemiology is one of the main reasons for all the confusion surrounding nutrition. Stating a hypothesis as a fact is a problem for many reasons, most important of which is just because 2 factors correlate does not mean that one is causing the other. The strong correlation between shark attacks and ice cream sales doesn't mean that the next time you pick up a soft serve, you should be avoiding the ocean. British sailors contracting scurvy from a diet rich in beef, beer, and biscuits doesn't mean that eliminating plants will kill you from a lack of micronutrients. Dr. James Lynn discovered that sailors can add citrus to their diets to prevent scurvy, leading to the current belief that meat has no vitamin C. Despite British sailors often eating rats to cure themselves of scurvy, the USDA has still never tested meat for its vitamin C content, leading to the 0% listed on nutritional labels. Independent studies show that a pound of muscle meat contains around 15 milligrams of vitamin C, while organs contain around 30 to 40 milligrams for every 100 grams. More than enough to give us the 10 milligrams we need to prevent scurvy, and getting us closer to the recommended daily allowance of 60 to 80 milligrams per day. One explanation for why the sailors got scurvy is is because they were eating cured meat products, while another is that they were eating empty carbohydrates, which break down to glucose and compete for the same cellular transport in the intestines as vitamin C, inhibiting its uptake into the body. This would mean that we need more vitamin C in the presence of dietary carbs. Improving my skin and preventing a cavity are strong indications that scurvy is not an issue, so vitamin C must be present. But what about other micronutrients? There are two types of essential micronutrients, vitamins and minerals. In his book, The Carnivore Code, Dr. Paul Saladino claims that we can get all the micronutrients we need from animal products in greater abundance than we can find them in plants. You can think of plants and animals as running on two separate operating systems. While some programs or nutrients are available on both, they're written in different languages. We can find vitamin A as beta-carotene in plants and retinol in animals. But we need 21 times more beta-carotene to get the same value as retinol. Similar situations can be found throughout the vitamin alphabet. We can make these alternative versions compatible, but it's far more work than running on our native programming language. I have yet to experience any symptoms that would indicate a vitamin deficiency, but where my experience diverges from Dr. Paul's knowledge is in the second group of micronutrients, minerals. Specifically electrolytes, including magnesium, potassium, and calcium, which we require for physiological function, including muscle contractions and injury repair. After 4 months of eating nothing but meat, I'm experiencing consistent muscle spasms throughout the day, which often progress into crippling cramps. Going for one long walk landed me with such horrible foot pain that I've been limping around for a week, avoiding all physical activity and experiencing no improvements. I might be surviving without plants, but I'm certainly not thriving, which is the main reason I started this diet to begin with. For the first time in over 4 months, my health is becoming a real concern. Mineral deficiencies can be life-threatening, but these symptoms also don't mean that we need plants to survive. There's a debate amongst carnivore dieters over what animal products we need to consume, with Dr. Paul leading the charge on a nose-to-tail approach.
A nose-to-tail approach to a carnivore diet thinks, I'm not just gonna eat the tenderloin and throw the rest of the animal out. We're gonna eat every piece of that animal, because every piece of that animal has calories and every piece of that animal has micronutrients that are unique.
For the past 5 weeks, I've been exclusively eating muscle meat from beef. Can reintroducing foods like organs, bone broth, eggs, or seafood address the issues that I'm experiencing? If I can address these issues through animal products and survive without plants, does that mean that I'll thrive? Are there any benefits to incorporating some plants in the diet or consequences to the long-term consumption of meat? Subscribe to this channel to follow along as I investigate these questions by building up my diet from the foundation, adding one food at a time, studying its nutritional profile and evolutionary origin while experiencing its impacts on me. Can we find the optimal diet by building from the ground up? That's what I'm going to find out. Thank you all for watching, and I'm excited to continue sharing this journey with all of you.